Have you ever read it? Timothy, I believe, was angry, distraught, and sick. We think that Paul was writing scriptures when he wrote Timothy. So then he's just going to address some real good things. And in these real good things that he addresses, you know, he'll just throw them in there because these are going to be scriptures. Not the case. When Paul wrote that, he wrote it because he was writing specifically to Timothy. He tells Timothy something like this. Timothy, wait a minute. God came to save sinners and whom I'm the chief of. Timothy, it's okay. People go sin. He said, Timothy, this is a trustworthy statement and it is supposed to be believed. He says that all throughout 1 Timothy. He says, listen, if a man desires to be an elder, he desires a good work. Elders ain't bad, Timothy. They ain't bad. He said, don't be mad. He said, when you rebuke somebody, you just don't go off on them. He said, you got to appeal to them a certain way. He says, but when you do, it makes sure it's in front of everybody so that no one else will sin. They'll all be scared to sin. And he said, and Timothy, you might want to stop drinking water. Take a little wine for your stomach, because you're always sick. Can you? He's sick again. Paul's sick again. Y'all are sick again. Timothy, stop drinking the water. Take a little wine with your diet. He ministered to that church. This is what is said in 1 Timothy chapter 4. When we turn to 1 Timothy chapter 4, Paul has words of encouragement to Timothy. He says this, let no one look down on your youthfulness, but rather in speech, conduct, love, faith, and purity. Show yourself an example of those who believe. Until I come, give attention to the public reading of Scripture, to exhortation and teaching. Do not neglect the spiritual gift within you, which was bestowed on you through prophetic utterance with the laying on of hands by the presbytery. Take pains with these things. Be absorbed in them so that your progress will be evident to all. Pay close attention to yourself and to your teaching. Persevere in these things, for as you do this, you will ensure salvation both for yourself and those who hear you. He also says in 1 Timothy 6, right over the page, at verse number 12, he says, fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called, and you made a good confession in the presence of many witnesses. You see, as Christians, sometimes we want things, but we're not willing to work for them. What I'm saying is, as Christians, a lot of times we want things, but we're not willing to work for them. If you're in this room right now, you want something. The people who don't want nothing of God, they're not here. But if you're here, no matter if you are a gung-ho Christian or a halfway Christian, you're here in this room. Everyone falls into one of those categories or categories somewhere in between. What I'm saying is, you're here for a reason. You want something. But so many of us, so many times, we want something that's godly, but we're not willing to work for it. We want a close relationship with God, but we're not willing to work for it. We want godly action. We want blessings from God. We want godly children. We want to have godly thoughts. And we want to view the world in a way that God views, so we won't have to struggle through all these anxieties and all these things that stress us. But what I'm saying is, if you want all these things, these blessings from God, these godly actions, these godly children, they're just not going to pop out. See, whenever Aaron told that to Moses, you gotta know what Moses was thinking. Well, Aaron, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard. Right. You mean to tell me that they just took off the gold, threw it in there, and then the calf just popped out? Stuff ain't just gonna pop out. Right. But that's how we act. And the deal is, nothing bad is gonna just pop out, nothing good is gonna pop out. We know the things that are good ain't gonna pop out, but in the same way, bad things just don't pop out either. We struggle with pride and selfishness, laziness, uncommittedness to things in general, uncommittedness to God. We can't get committed. That's not just going to pop out either. Amen. See, what happened is, somewhere along the way, something happened to you, and you did some things to you. And it didn't just pop out. This pride, I can never admit I'm wrong. I can never give things to people. I only worry about me and mine. That just didn't pop out. That was fashioned. It was fashioned in us. Amen. just don't pop out. If we want good things from God, we will have to work for good things. If we want to avoid bad things that are not of God, we have to work against them. But either way, it takes work, because good things nor bad things just ain't gonna pop out. When the prophet Haggai speaks in chapter 2, he says something very interesting beginning at verse number 12. Brother Jackson and I will be given sermons on this at a later time. It's a very interesting concept. This is what the prophet Haggai says. He says, this is what the Lord says. He says, okay, if a man carries in the fold of his garment meat that has been consecrated, if that meat touches something else, does that something else become consecrated? They said, no. He said, okay, on the flip side, what if a man touches a dead body? If he touches this dead body, and then he touches something else, does that become defiled? Yes. He said, if something is consecrated, and you touch it and brush up against it, it's not consecrated just because it brushed up against it. He said, but if it's defiled, and he touches the dead man's body, and he touches enough, every single thing he touches becomes defiled. What Haggai is saying is, it's a difference. It's a difference between getting consecrated and getting defiled. The rules to make something clean is 10 times harder than the rules to make something dirty. What I'm saying is, when I was a child, I was a wild, bounce off the walls nutcase. I was screaming, I was all over the place. And everybody in the church knew. In classes, in school, they would have my brother in school. And they'd say, oh, Dave, I just love Dave. Well, then they found out, well, you don't have Brian, his little brother. That's my first name, Brian. Well, you're going to have Brian, his little brother. And then they go, I'm thinking of retirement. I did my best. 20 years was enough. I was an awful child. When I was sitting at the table, I was messy. When I would eat, you always knew, because there was exhibits everywhere. Exhibit A on my shirt. Exhibit A on the table. On the floor. You know, a dog got up there. And even today, I struggle with it. I'm eating, and hey, it's like, I mean, is this happening right now, or is this, you know? But the thing is, I would be eating, and then I would get up from the table, and food would be on my behind. And my dad would say, son, how do you get food on your backside to eat? What I'm saying is, to make something dirty, it's really easy. It's very easy to make something dirty. But hey, God's saying is, it ain't the same. Do you know, in order to wash clothes, in the old days, you know, when we went to Panama, we seen people doing it old school, not just old school, like, but we put up, like, hooks in our backyard. We saw people in Panama with a shirt on a rock in the river. They put soap on it. Then they take a brush. They brush it out like this. One garment, each garment, the exact same way, they brush it out like that. And then they rinse it. Repeat the process. I'm sitting here looking. It's hard work. You got to do that with every single garment. And even today we have washers. Do you know somebody has to come up with an invention that takes electricity, that takes money to run, that took money to make, that took money to purchase, in order for us to put garments inside of this thing. And they go around and around and around for about 20 minutes. Around and around. Then they go into the dryer, and then they go around and around to dry. Do you know that to clean a garment takes an hour? But with one cup of very small grape juice, I can make the garment dirty immediately. The rules for consecration and defilement are not the same. What I'm saying is, even if something did pop out, it'll pop out bad before it pop out good. Does that make sense? Stuff ain't gonna pop out. We are expecting to just come to church, and that's how we do. We live a life of defilement. We live a life of defilement, and then we want to get consecrated. And we say, well, it must be the same rules, okay? Well, I go to the club once a week. That's how I do. I go to the club once a week. So, and that's me being defiled. I do defiled things in the club once a week. So, if I want to get consecrated, I just go to church once a week. And now I'm consecrated. But see, it don't work that way. Because you're using the same rules for defilement as you are consecration. But in order for something to become consecrated, something to become good, it takes 10 times more.